15. Or they went all the way down to the next one. Go, you guys go all the way down. All the way. All the way down to the next one. Because we want to get the, we just want to get the steps in the campaign.
Yeah, all we right. want the steps to emulate those because all the early pictures are like that.
First thing I want to say about the 100 years, it's not just going to start when we have our first basketball game. We've been working on this for a year and a half. Coach Canterbury and I are dangerous together.
You know, we've planned about this 100 year for a couple years. It's just so great that we have kids involved that we're going to embrace it. You know, it's great that Coach Price is now part of, think about, man, you're the head coach in 200 year celebrations.
We started putting some things together and all of a sudden, we got some momentum on this. We're putting it up. We're putting flags out there. And we got, you know, Castilliums helping us with some metal. And we're going to put some coins out of Mandy and Kate's. And they're going to stamp them. And then we thought, hey, we got to get some shirts with the 100-year stuff on. So Swifties is making a bunch of shirts. And we've got them all over the place. And then we're doing a documentary. And we're going to do it. And now we got signs up in the gym. And I mean, little by little, stuff's coming. And then we got a Facebook. I don't even have Facebook. Coach Wise, who's the tech guy of all of us, talked me into it. And said, we can reach a lot of people.
I'm going into my 11th year now with the program, which is unreal to me to even think about. And to be a part of the tradition and the history of Ravenswood basketball is amazing to me.
I'm really proud of all the people that has jumped in and said, what do you need, Mick? What do you guys need? I'll do whatever you need. People in Ravenswood are blessed to live in this town. They really are. And we're going to have a great 100-year celebration, and it's going to be memorable, not only for this team that's playing this year. How great is that? They're playing in the 100th season. But all the guys that come back, just to give them a little piece of, this is what it used to be when I lived here.
I'll never forget the day that I saw the video on you're from Ravenswood page. And I filmed it on my phone and I got hold of Coach and I said, look, we've got to get Chase to do this. And I was just, and I've told Chase many times, all we wanted was a 3 or 4 minute video. He has taken this documentary to another level. Every single person that's been a part of it, it's just, you know, they can't believe that they're a part of it.
Ravenswood basketball deserves this documentary because I think Ravenswood basketball means so much to so many that I think that this is gonna be one of those things that will last a long, long time. People can go back and watch it years from now.
One of the greatest things that we decided to do was to get Chase Jarrell to do a documentary. I never dreamed we'd be flying a drone or seeing pieces or clips to get people to peek for the 100 years on a Facebook from what Chase Jarrell has done on this documentary. I just thought we would get something and kind of hook it together and let people see it. Hey, that was nice. And I remember when they went to the state tournament and I remember when they played. Yeah, it was nice. They did something on those old guys, you know, back in the day. He's made it a living piece of legend. He's made this something that's going to be around forever that they can look back to and say, oh my gosh, look at this. He's interviewing guys that played in the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s. Oh my, look at the collection of people and just talking about the history.
And, you know, doing this type of stuff, the documentary, the 100 years in the program celebration, getting the players back, It's something everybody can be proud of.
Saturday, is there anything else that, nice thoughts?
Just one more thing. Oh, baby.
Ravenswood had, at that time, probably around 1,200 people in the city. Of course, the city was much smaller, basically from where the old high school set to Sand Creek and from the river to Preston Street. That was the town at that time. It maintained pretty steady, but my understanding is it had a lot to do with, it, like in the early 1900s, West Virginia University started playing basketball, college basketball, and it was a thing that they needed to do in the wintertime. They needed something they could do inside. And when a lot of the boys had come back from the war, they brought with them some of that, you know, the basketball and other things, but basketball in particular. And I guess it kind of caught on as a pastime in the wintertime here. And when they built a new school, obviously they had an indoor gym, which they didn't have before. Now they had a couple of facilities they could use. That is kind of what put the wheels in motion to get their own team. And of course, I said like in 21, 22, when the new high school was built, 21, 22 was their first year.
In 1922, when Ravenswood started playing boys basketball, there was a lot of rule changes that was in effect, and many of them could be seen in that 1922 gym. Having interviewed some of the people that played in the 1922 school, most people would not know this unless you played during that time or you were in school during that time, but that was a very small gym. Matter of fact, there were no out-of-bounds lines on the side, the wall. So if the ball touched the wall or you scraped your elbow on the wall, you're out of bounds. Underneath, they would move it out 2 or 3 feet to extend the basket away from the wall, but that was done by rule because when the baskets were put against the wall, so many of the players got hurt by just going up and hitting against the wall. So it wasn't a whole bunch of room in gyms like that. So when they played in front of packed gyms, of course they were packed.
The main thing about the 1922 gym, and we've had some debate ever since we started. Well, this gym has been called the Pit for a long time, but it's always been a discussion about where did that name came from. And most people, it came from the gym that was in that 1922 school. I mean, because it was down in, you walked into the school and then you walked down into the gym. And they called it the Pit because it was so small and because of the way it was constructed. To me, some of the most interesting information is the fact that, you know, Ravenswood basketball through the years has always had, you know, winning teams. The research that I found was even more than I thought it would be.
The Depression, it didn't hit Ravenswood as bad because they didn't have as much to lose. I mean, most of them was country folks, locally employed, so it wasn't really as bad. I mean, of course, the stocks and bonds, which is what really got a lot of people, weren't so prevalent here. I mean, I'm sure there was a few people that had things like that, but as a whole, it just slowed down the growth. I mean, we didn't keep going from the 20s up into the 30s and into the 40s because of that, of the Depression. And contact with the outside world wasn't as good at that time. And we didn't have, you know, of course, obviously there's no social media.
I guess because of the Depression is what everyone keeps coming back to. There are just not any records of those.
Step aside, partner, it's my day. Bend an ear and listen to my version. Pardon me, boy, is that the Chattanooga juju?
Yes, yes, track 29.
Boy, you can give me a shine.
Can you afford to board Chattanooga juju?
I got my fare
and just a trifle to spare.
December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
Looking at the old newspapers, you would see the roles of the boys going off to war, which, you know, they were men, but they were boys. And it's just unbelievable how many went off from this small. I had no idea. After I sold my business, I helped at the cemetery 5 days a week, either mowing, weed eating, digging graves, whatever. All the bronze plaques up there are the people who was in World War II. I mean, it's just phenomenal in a small town this small, how many boys went off to war, and then the newspaper accounts of a lot of them didn't make it back. I mean, you know, so football, basketball, baseball, they all took a backseat at that time. There wasn't as many games played. They tried to keep them going because you had to have something for people to hang their hat on. One of the coaches was trying to find somebody who had rationing tickets so they could send, I can't remember if it was the football or the basketball team, they needed gasoline to get to an opponent.
If I'm unable to unearth some fans willing to share the gasoline with the boys and make possible games with Ripley, Cottageville, and Gilmore, then I'm going hunting for a Surrey and a team of horses. Carter Linger.
They played a lot of, I'm assuming the basketball and the football both, played a lot of teams that was on the railroad. The railroad was a mean of transportation. So that's what they did back. A lot of people didn't have cars, you know, and so, you know, traveling was done, not done by the school itself, but by the individuals or by train or bus.
The roads are the dustiest, the winds are the gustiest, we talk. The gates are
so
the
I'm really excited about the interview that we're doing. We're doing a documentary. It's kind of like those ones on ESPN, 30 for 30. So I appreciate you and your son doing it tonight. And thank you for being on it.
Well, I'm more than happy to be on it.
Well, if you don't mind, we'll go ahead and get started here.
Oh, sure. We live in North Carolina, Cornelius. Very close to Charlotte.
What was it like for you growing up in Ravenswood?
Oh, it was a very close-knit town. As far as the kids all congregated together, the families did. The basketball, football, and all the sports, those were the activities that drew the you know, the parents out to school. But prior to our 1950 team, Ravenswood never went to the state tournament or anything like that. But we as kids, we talked about the state tournament a lot. We're going to go there. And so it ended up, we made it, but we only were there for one game. And there was a situation there where Ray Ritchie fell and sprained his ankle and his knee. In fact, his senior year, he was only a junior, but we had a good knit team. And I think you'll remember I told you, we had an uptown and a downtown.
That's right, so, and I wanted to ask you about that because that was, I like that, that was neat.
Yeah.
So you had a team that you played uptown and some of you guys were downtown and you go to different places and play.
That's right, and we play about once a week.
The next question I have was, what was it like playing in the 1922 school's gym?
It was difficult, but we just went ahead and played. Number one, at the end of the court, that's where the players sat when they weren't in the ball game. So if a ball went out of bounds in one of those corners like that, you had to move over and get out of the guy's way so he could pass the ball in. Now, the first crow's nest was over against the far wall, the wall towards the football field.
Right.
And those were where the windows were.
Right.
But at a crow's nest there, and you had to run and jump and grab the bottom of the crow's nest to pull yourself up and then swing over the outside board to get inside the crow's nest, and that's where you kept score.
Many of the players, when you were younger, shot their foul shots underhanded.
Oh, yes. I was the only one who could shoot one hand. Everybody else shot underhand.
You guys beat Parkersburg.
We sure did.
And at one time, when you played, they were the biggest high school on the East Coast of the United States. They had 3,500 students, and Ravenswood had less than 300, if I'm not mistaken.
247.
What was that like going to Parkersburg and beating Parkersburg, being the small town and going up and taking on the giant and winning up there? What was that like?
Well, back before the season started, we talked about it and how we were going to beat Parkersburg. And we believed, and many of the guys in town that were really, you know, basketball fans, oh, you're not the part. I said, yes, we are. We're going to win. We went up there. We didn't have too much advantage of anything other than we believed we could win. And all of them, it was Parkersburg 40, Ravenswood 47.
That's great. And I want to show you something. This is in my dressing room. Can you see it?
Oh, my land. Yes.
I'm so appreciative of you, Mr. Short, and all you have done in Ravenswood and what you've meant to the Ravenswood basketball program. Thank you so much.
I appreciate you contacting us.
Will you stay in good health and keep rooting for the Red Devils? We're going to try to win a few this year.
We'll do that. Thank you very much, Coach. Okay. Appreciate
Thank
it.
Thank you. Good night. You. Good night.
Aluminum put Henry into every home in America. He'd broken a long-standing monopoly. This new enterprise divided and subdivided, producing and reproducing at an astounding rate. Against the advice of his executives, Henry got into the house.
Well, you're coming after World War II, and many of the boys that were in school went to service, and so they're coming back home. And so after World War II, when they came back into the Ravenswood area, some of them were looking for homes, they're looking for jobs. There's some of them going back to school in the GI Bill. So it was there was a lot of changes. But obviously, the biggest change in Ravenswood was going from really a farmland community to a community that was going to be governed by the plant, Kaiser Aluminum.
No one to walk with, but I'm happy on the shelf. A misbehaving, saving my love for you.
Oh, it was a world difference. You know, you're talking about, I think in Ravenswood in 1950 had around 800 people. In 1960, I'm thinking it was 6,000. So, I mean, everything was bulging. They had to build a new elementary. They had to build a new high school in 61. The local grocers had these people coming from California asking for things they'd never heard of.
Kaiser wanted to put a lot of money into the educational system, the building of schools, the helping of the tax bases, because if their people were going to come here to work, they wanted a good school system. So Ravenswood benefited greatly from having Kaiser Aluminum come in. Then there was a place for all those guys who come back from World War II to have a job, to build a community, and so this community really started growing after that time in the number, in the population.
The local businessmen were really energetic and they would go out and get things. And they created this thing called the 14 Club. And the 14 Club would go out and get famous entertainment. And they even brought Louis Armstrong in and he entertained in the gymnasium. That was one of the things that happened out here around the pit. So it made that a fun place to go as well as a basketball place.
By the time that gym was built in 1950, many of those guys told me from the difference of playing in that 1922 gym and the difference of playing here was like you playing here and then going to Madison Square Garden. It just was so huge, they weren't ready for all that openness of all that new gym.
We practiced for an hour or so every day. At the end of the day, we'd sometimes go over, and we had some things we had to do, which were, you might say, conditioning exercises. We'd build strength and endurance for being able to run up and down the floor fast without running out of breathing ability. But then we'd get into running some practice plays and practice shooting and so forth.
Coach Spano, who was my coach, let me out at 3:15 so I could catch a bus because I lived out in the country. And it was hard to get home at that time because of traffic and you didn't have cars like you got today.
We had different uniforms, I guess, depending upon whether we had money to buy them from year to year. The school had money to buy them from year to year. We wore shirts that were kind of like t-shirts. They were like white t-shirts with a short sleeve?
Well, they were red and black, but they was pretty simple. And the best I can remember, we only had one set of uniforms. You taking them home and washed them after the game, and then you brought them back the next day. We were playing Point Pleasant at Point Pleasant, and they were bound and determined that I wasn't going to score a lot. So every time I got the ball, they fouled me, and I had like 24 points at halftime, but only 2 points was field goals. In fact, they tore my trunks off of me. They had to stop the game, and a boy that didn't get to play much went to the locker room, and him and I changed trunks. And I come back out and used his trunks the rest of the game, and he sat there in his jeans.
Points weren't really that important to me. It was unusual when I made those 250 points my junior year, one game, and 48 in my senior year. But those two games, even though I made a lot of points, weren't really my favorites, because you have to remember, basketball is not a one-person sport. You know, there are five people out there, and each one's doing their best for the team to win, not for one person to win. So we tried to make it so that whoever was most likely to score in a certain situation was the one that shot. Sometimes it was the person that was the set shots, sometimes it was the person the jump shot, sometimes it was a fast break. So we try to utilize our whole team, and sometimes we would have everybody on the team scoring in double figures. And those would be my favorite games when the whole team won.
The crowds were tremendous. In fact, for a small town, the gym would be packed, and the noise, and it may seem odd, but I can remember that feeling when you come out on the floor. There was a lot of emotion. I mean, it was jam-packed with kids and even older people, you know. It was kind of a town-supported atmosphere, you know. They were behind us.
These are the kids that's going to be playing in our fall league. Fellas, this is Dean Moore. He's one of the all-time great players here at Ravenswood High School. He played in
55, 56,
those years. Scored 50 points in one game, scored 48 in one game. No three-point line. So he was 6'4", and
gravity gone.
He is 83 years old, tickled to death that he's back here at Ravenswood. When he played here, there was not a rectangular backboard. They were fan-shaped like that, and they were 10. But this gym was built in 1950, and this was referred to as the new gym, because in the school that's on the side here that you see the picture of, there was a gym downstairs. He has had an illustrious career, fellas. He's got his doctorate degree. He's written books. He's written books about Ravenswood. He's taught at several colleges and universities. He's from Cincinnati, and he's back today for a reunion. And just tickled to death to have him back. So I want you to introduce yourselves to Mr. Moore, one of the all-time greats for Ravenswood.
Matthew Cartwright.
Nice to meet you.
I'm Anthony Engel.
Nice to meet you.
Hayden Sharp.
Nice to meet you.
Drew Hunt.
Nice to meet you.
Pastor Miller.
Nice to meet you.
So good.
You guys are pretty good here. I can tell just from your one-on-ones that you're playing. My suggestion would be find your best shot. What are you really good at? And make that the best, keep practicing that. So they always need you in a certain place. If there's somebody that is in a place where they can shoot a jump shot, where's the jump shot expert? If somebody can shoot set shots, develop your best shot.
Rattle those pots and pans. Get out in that kitchen and
the crowds were tremendous. If you didn't get here by the start of the JV game, you didn't get a seat, and half the time you couldn't get in the building because it was standing room only. And noise, you could hear yourself think. Now my wife, she could whistle the loudest anybody you ever heard, and I could distinguish that above the crowd.
What was your favorite memory or favorite game playing for the Ravenswood?
Probably when we beat Ripley. Yeah. Double the score, 74-37. Probably my favorite game of all of them. Because the year before they really, I won't say anymore.
Not for a
camera. Not for a
camera. Pitt to me was Boston Garden. I mean, that was the place to be. And the gymnasium, I watched it being built. It was built in 50. And I watched the walls go, because I lived right across the street. And I was always the last guy to get in the gymnasium. And there were some great teams back then. One of our opponents on the regular schedule was a school by the name of Parkersburg Catholic High School. And in my mind, that had to be one of the best high school teams the state's ever seen. They had a 7-foot center, 6'8" forward, 6'6" guy named Dick Wilk, and the two Santa brothers were guards, 6'1", 6'2". It was a terrific basketball team. They were unbeaten during the regular season for 2 or 3 years. And I've always said that was the best high school team I think I witnessed in my day. And all 5 players went to college to play ball. It was a terrific high school.
We were playing Wahama. And, you know, I got mad and took a swing at it. And the referee didn't see it. They had thrown me out of the ball game. I'm glad they didn't see that. Now I forgot that guy's name. I'm just too old for this. But that was a tough ball game.
Jim coached, head coached football and basketball. His assistant coach was Joe Bakovich, the head coach in baseball. And Jim had a great influence, not only on the athletes, but students in school. He was a very unique individual. Tough in sports, he would lean on you, but he did it in such a way that it didn't alienate you. Had some good teams in basketball and died at 33 years old. That was a tragedy for the town of Ravenswood because he was well-liked here and statewide. The sports writers all liked him. He's a great individual, and he had such an influence on former players that I can tell you that some of the former players would have not made it through high school if it wasn't for Jim Spano. He was just a great guy. Like a second father to all of us.
Graduated. We practiced right after school. Practices, we had junior varsity and varsity a lot of times going at the same time, so it was a lot of people in the gym. A lot of scrimmaging, really. A lot of scrimmaging after we got things intact. Now we had our certain drills that we ran, but still more scrimmaging than anything. Today's uniforms are so much cooler than what we had, I guarantee. Ours was tight fitting. I mean, oh, give me a break. Our uniforms, you know, the shorts, I mean, the shorts were, you know, short. But all in all, you know, now the uniforms was very unique. I mean, they were nice. They were very nice. Ravenswood always had a tradition to put nice uniforms out there. Going into our senior year, we had the Big Reds on our schedule. And this is before there was 2 schools. there was just one. It was one of the biggest schools this side of Mississippi, huge school. They were 5-0, and we were 5-0. And we went to a home court. Of course, their paper had an article the day before talking about, well, both teams is undefeated, but yet it's Ravenswood and we're the Big Reds. Well, we went up there and beat them. And again, their gym was packed that night too. It was by far, I think, the best win we had. By far, beating the Big Reds on their home court.
Tell me what the Ripley rivalry is like for you.
You go to the record books. We beat them the worst they've probably ever been beat. We scored, if I remember right, 113 points on them and rubbed every minute of it. We beat them six times. Rubbed every minute of it. Anytime you beat the Vikings, it's a good day.
Well, the thing about it was, is there was so many more people in the town. The gym was always packed. I mean, it was loud and it was noisy. And the teams were competitive. It just was always that atmosphere when they came. You had to get in here early, you had to get a ticket. And you could tell by the people standing out front. I mean, they'd be lined all the way to the street because the games were always good. The competition was good. We played bigger teams back then. You know, a lot of bigger teams and a more rambunctious crowd. Had us up fights every now and then. I mean, it's just made for entertainment.
The first thoughts that come to my mind is the 1970 and 71-72 teams. They had a really good basketball team, but like a lot of teams in that era, they just weren't quite good enough to go to Charleston. They had the athletes to do it. Obviously, West Virginia was a lot bigger then. It was a much harder road to get to the state tournament. Only four teams went in AA at that time. The 1971 team is when I started going to almost every game, home and away. That 71-72 team, they were both super teams. They both made it to the regional finals back when, again, only four teams made it.
If we win the sectional and regional championships, I'll ride a bicycle into the Ohio River from the ferry, Jack Wiseman.
The 71 team lost by 1 point in overtime. 72 team lost by 3 points in overtime, both to New Martinsville. And for people that really know Ravenswood sports history, that's when Ravenswood and New Martinsville formed a rival.
Yeah, I'm Chris Skeens. Well, Christopher Skeens. With a lot of different nicknames when I played basketball here at school. One of my favorites was Ichabod Crane. So was able to grow up with just an amazing amount of kids. Seemed like Ravenswood was just full of kids, and myself, Chris Skeens, was one of those. Every outside basketball court that we could find, and even made some ourselves out of driveways, there was a basketball game going on somewhere. And those are some of my fondest memories. I remember one time I asked my dad to just, can I have a basketball goal on our driveway? And so he said, sure. And sure enough, he went to Jayco Lumber, bought the plywood. I think he purchased the rim here locally as well, and the net, and put it up on top of the carport. And we had, after school, we would have basketball games there. And my mom would yell, you know, out the window, it's time to come and eat. And so all of a sudden, you know, it just wasn't me. It was a kitchen full of kids, but that's the way it was growing up in Ravenswood. Oh, the shoes. You know, canvas Chuck Taylor Converse was the shoe. It was the shoe that every basketball player had to have. I had quite a challenge convincing my dad to purchase me a pair of canvas Chuck Taylor Converse because at Cox's department store, you could buy two pair of Uniroyal canvas tennis shoes for $5. And I was hard on tennis shoes. My feet were growing so fast, okay. And I remember when I finally convinced Dad, you can jump better in them, you can run faster, your cuts are more clean. And he said, okay, I'm gonna buy you a pair. He said, but I never dreamed I'd pay $12 for a pair of tennis shoes. I just remember running out, to do our pregame sets. And my goodness, the place just erupted. Just erupted. And the noise was just stimulating. You know? And you're just in your element all at once. And here we come with those new uniforms and those red suede all-star Chuck Taylor Converse. And I don't know, it almost seemed like you were a celebrity. My senior year when we played Ripley High School here in the pit, it was the best game of my career. You know, just like 19 points, 18 rebounds, 12 assists. I mean, it's just one of those games that, you know, it wasn't a 30-point game or anything like that, but it was just a balanced game. We rarely played a 1-3-1 defense, but for some reason, Coach Wiseman, in the third quarter, it was a close game, and he called timeout and he said, let's go 1-3-1. I loved it. It was a lot of responsibility for the defensive player that's playing in the middle. And I was just waiting for the opportunity and it occurred. And the place was going crazy. It's getting close to the end of the third quarter. And I kept waiting for that number two guard for Ripley to try to make that long pass back to the point guard. Here it comes. And he did it. And I got a jump on the ball. I stole it. And I went down. And I knew I wasn't supposed to do this, but wham! Man, the dunk, I think Coach Canterbury wrote about it, you know? And I mean, the place just erupted. The place just erupted. And just to tell you the truth, I don't remember a technical foul. I mean, there had to have been, because that was the rules. But I just remember it was just an amazing game. And we just, from there on out in the fourth quarter, it was we just took over the game.
Talked about the young firebrand that was coming to town to coach the team. Well, I never seen Coach Hupp or Coach Wiseman slam their clipboard down on the floor.
I knew from the get-go that he would be the kind of guy that could take Ravenswood basketball to another level.
And he gives it 110%. He doesn't know how to do anything otherwise.
And there you hear the red hot cheer from the Ravenswood fans. Let's hope it is red hot against whoever they're playing Saturday night, be it Gilmer County or Williamstown.
The person that I got the information for about the job that was open here was Joe Dorsey. Joe Dorsey and I were friends at Fremantle State College, and he had told me at the LKC All-Star game that there was going to be a job opening, that the coach that was here, Coach Wiseman, was going to go into the administration. And he goes, the city of Ravenswood would like to have someone who was young, energetic. I actually applied for it. I interviewed for it. And next thing I know, I'm getting a job and I'm coaching football, assistant football coach at Sistersville. And they're telling me, we're in a position to hire you as the head basketball coach at Ravenswood.
When I got to know Coach, I could tell that he was going to be the type of coach just because of his energy and his enthusiasm and his knowledge that Ravenswood was going to go, to just a different level in basketball.
I wanted to build a program from the bottom up. And I wanted to produce a product, a group of players. But anytime they walked on the floor, someone would have to say, you guys better get ready to play tonight. You're playing Ravenswood. You're going to have to play 32 minutes if you want to beat that team, because they're going to get after it. And I wanted that known all over the state of West Virginia, not just here. They had to buy into what I'm bringing. That wasn't easy for a lot of them. That first year, I'm storming the court, and I'm running up and down, and I'm taking charges, and I'm diving for balls, and they're like, what's this? What's going on here? Well, these are the expectations. I had to show them. Now, I was young enough at that time I could do that. I certainly wouldn't do that today. But, I mean, 26 years old, running up and down the court, it was no big deal to me. You got to play at this level, and this is what my expectations. We had to get better immediately because I wanted this team to get to the state tournament, something they hadn't done since 1950. I wanted to talk about it every day. I wanted to talk about winning. I wanted to talk about a winning culture. This has to happen, not just in the games. It has to happen in practice. It has to happen the way you look. It has to happen on being a good student, being a good person, discipline. Are you here on time? We just monumentally got to that in 1980 when that group that came through with me first actually upset Williamstown at Parkersburg Fieldhouse to go to the state tournament for the first time since the 1950s. the first thing I did when I got the job was I opened the front doors up the gym and turned some music on, and I started painting the floor. My problem was I didn't ask permission for it. It's a whole lot easier to tell someone you're sorry for doing than it is asking permission. So I started taping off people going like, what are you doing? I wanted them to come in and see what I was doing. I wanted people to walk up the street. See, he's painting black around the edge of the floor. What in the world is he doing? I wanted people to understand that we're going to get after this here. The other thing that I did was I turned an old room that we're presently sitting in now, that was a storage closet with all kind of stuff in here and just trash, into a dressing room. And people were going, what is he doing? They've got carpet in there. They got chairs, they got name tags up. I wanted that to take place.
I attended Marshall University, and while at Marshall University, I became friends with Jerry Bradley, who preceded me by one semester here at Ravenswood. And I saw there was a teaching job open, a social studies job open at Ravenswood High School, so I gave Jerry a call, and he said, sure, it's a great place to work, and he talked to Mick, and I came in and interviewed, and luckily got the job. So I started here in 1980, 1981. It was in the summertime, and Jerry Bradley and I went to Mick's house, and he was out back doing something. We just kind of sat down and talked, and he's easy to talk to and all that stuff, and we never looked back from there, and we had a lot in common. And, you know, we all love basketball, and we're all ultra competitive, and, you know, it just blossomed from there. We played each other's strengths and weaknesses. And I think, you know, that's one of the reasons why Ravenswood basketball has been so successful, is all the coaches are willing to do whatever it takes. Nobody's too good to do anything. You know, you have some coaches that, well, I don't want to go down and work with so-and-so, they're never going to play. Well, there's nobody like that in this program. And we've all swept the floor, mopped the floor, painted, you know. And so if players see coaches are willing to do anything, then why shouldn't they be willing to do anything?
I've always felt the reason that we have been successful in our program is because the kids that have been good, the kids whose names are on the wall, the kids that have had great seasons here have prepared themselves by working harder than others. Whether it be in the weight room, whether it be running, whether it be getting in the summer and getting shots up every day, whether it be working on their foul shooting, they've got stronger, they've outworked them. And that's kind of how I feel as a coach. Do I know as much as everybody other coach? Of course not. I don't even put myself in that position. But if you put me against him, I'm gonna outwork you. You can have all the stuff. You can have what money can buy. You can have the greatest stuff that you want. You can have the luxurious buses and things like that and all that stuff, but you're not gonna outwork us.
And that's kind of life, because sometimes things go your way and life is easy. Sometimes in life it doesn't go your way. So you're trying to instill in kids, no matter what the situation, you gotta work hard. I used to always tell kids, I said, if hard work paid off immediately, everybody would work hard. And so you got to work hard even though it doesn't pay off immediately. You know, the grind. You got to get into the grind. And that sometimes in life you have to grind. And so it's the same way in coaching. You just have to go through the process and try to get better in increments. And sometimes it's victories pays off in. Other times it pays off as kids learn to work hard. Remember a game that sticks out here in the pit, one that sticks out in my mind, and I just thought it was hilarious because it was such a big rivalry, was we played Racine Southern over here one night, and they had beaten us pretty good over at their place, and they were good. They were runner-up in the state of Ohio during that era. The Southern game in those days, there were people waiting to get in at 3:30 from Southern for us to open the doors to get in. And so it would be packed for the JV game. I was on the bench, and Jerry Bradley was the JV coach. Over at Southern, the JV game was just as important as varsity. So it is a wild crowd. The place is going crazy. And I believe Jim Ankrum had a three-point play to put us ahead. And in that game, the JV game, their varsity coach, their JV coach, and their freshman coach all got technicals. Anyway, we pulled it out and won. And I can remember Mick's big thing was, do not get the crowd into the game, the JV game. You don't want the opponents going nuts. And I can remember Jerry walking off the floor, raising his fist to the Southern crowd, and they just went nuts. And so the place is going crazy when the varsity game starts. Now, Southern was always a team, they'd make runs. They played maniacal and they'd always make big runs. And they got up on us 15 points in the first quarter or whatever, the varsity game. And we had a player named Will Bradley. Now, Will was a pretty good shooter, but he was in a terrible shooting slump. So they're playing their defense and they're leaving him open. But Will hits 5 3-pointers and we come back and beat them. And the place is going nuts. And so their crowd had been on Coach Price quite a bit. And so with about 30 seconds to go, some of their people start leaving. And Coach Price called a timeout. And their people are hollering at us, and he's asked, where are you going? The game's not over. And it was just one of those games you gotta sit back and laugh because that was such a heated rivalry. And we had a player step up that they thought couldn't do the job. And it's just one of the funniest. You enjoy a rivalry like that and you respect them, but you love to beat them.
Anybody who watched us play when I was playing, it would all probably have a different story to tell you because it was exciting times. I mean, some of the games against Ripley were amazing games because of the rivalry. But I have to say, the one that sticks out most to me was playing Southern. You've got Ohio versus West Virginia. It was a game where both teams, wasn't a lot of defense here, both teams scored over 100 points. And it was up and down the court. The gym was packed. I mean, along the baselines was 3 deep. You know, when you took the ball out, people were pulling the hair on your leg and kicking you. And I mean, it was so heated. And they had to have the Ravenswood wall here. We were definitely against code. I think the gym out here will hold 1,500. There were probably 2,300 people in the gym. The doors, they opened the doors and people were standing outside. And that was the most memorable game, because it was a really close game, not a lot of defense, and the intensity you could cut with a knife. And the level of noise was crazy. And the red wave against the purple tornadoes, it was fabulous. You know, I'll tell you what, there was nothing better than coming down to a home game. I lived on Fitzhugh, and again, I'd drive down here. I had my parking spot right in front of the gym because you got here before the crowds did, and it was fantastic. My junior year is when the red wave started. Student body to support our basketball team. It was fun. I mean, our basketball teams, my junior and senior year, we didn't have a three-point line. So we were getting up and down the floor. So it was exciting. It was a fun time. And the red wave started. That whole section of the gym was full of everybody. They had red t-shirts that had a black wave on it overflowing. And they were loud and it was awesome. We actually overtook that section we keep for the wave people. That would fill up with the red wave. I mean, the wave overflowed, so it was the best time.
It was not unusual during that period of time to stop a game to find toilet paper all over the place because those kids were throwing it out all over the floor on the first basket made. So it was pretty neat, and I was willing to take a technical for it. I didn't care. I wanted the students to have fun. They're supporting their kids. It's 1 point. If we can't get that back, okay, whatever.
It was so exciting. And then we had a mascot, and he would paint up as a devil. And I'm telling you, it was a big time, fun time. I mean, I'm getting goosebumps feeling it now. interesting game was the first night of champions in Parkersburg Fieldhouse.
Bernie Reese's team, I think in 1987, was a pretty special group. Those guys really worked hard. They really started getting it. Travis Thompson could shoot the ball with anybody in the state. One of the greatest shooters that I coached.
That team, they were just ahead of their time, man. They had phenomenal talent.
And it was an amazing game.
There's a couple that come to my mind really quickly. One of them would have been when we went up against, I believe undefeated at the time, number one ranked, St. Mary's in the Night of Champions. And I'm sure a lot of people out there thought, well, we got a good team. Ravenswood is pretty good. We'll be competitive. And, you know, we were playing at the field house and big crowd, lower and upper levels. And Coach Price had a great game plan. We had a good team and we shut them down. And, you know, it wasn't close. I mean, we beat them like 75 to 47 or something very similar to that. And that game and that kind of excitement in the field house, which was the only other thing that I had played in at the time that really felt awesome like the Pit did. You know, it's like, wow, this is fun being out here playing. And so to be able to have that kind of moment on a big stage, you get hot in the third quarter of that game, and I had great teammates that when I got hot, they did, you know, get him the ball. So give a lot of credit to those guys for getting me whenever I was hot. And so in that third quarter, it was very memorable for me personally, winning an LKC championship, doing it on that floor with my guys, and you know, against that team, that was pretty awesome. Differences between, you know, basketball when I played in the late 80s and early 90s compared to today, I think we were right on the verge of transitioning over to the three-point line. And it just came in whenever I was in high school. And we utilized it. I mean, we made a lot of threes, myself, Brian Dale, Jason Masiunas. And that was one of the strengths of our team, that we had pretty tight chemistry. We were, you know, around each other a lot. And I think that chemistry and friendship just made us a better team and a stronger team. And back then, Coach was full of fire, so it was an interesting combination for sure.
We had a white uniform, I think my number was 33, and the black uniform, I think my number was 32. I always loved Magic Johnson, Larry Bird, so those are the numbers I chose. And I know Coach Canterbury, who coached me up from grade school, but really middle school up, he always pushed me toward those type players.
High school girls track at the time. You know, 1989 was special to me because now I'm coaching the kids that I just coached in middle school. Some of the kids that I'm still closest to today, like Chris Michael, you know, he still teaches here. I talk to him almost every day. Guys like Brian Dale that still live here, and Ron Varney that, you know, just lived over in Ripley. So it wasn't that hard to come up and coach because I knew what was expected. So it was fun. And, you know, we just pretty much carried on the same things. I, you know, just tried to bring a different perspective to the coaching. I moved up because Coach Bradley left and went to Green Murray. So it was a smooth transition, but, you know, I've enjoyed every minute of it.
My recollection of the pit, I mean, the crowd was, I mean, it was always packed, and it was so hot. I mean, I bet you I lost 10 pounds every game. I mean, just sweat. But I mean, it was just, and you would see it in the visiting team. They weren't used to that, but we practiced in it every day. We weren't phased coming fourth quarter. Those guys were dragging, and we were, you know, we were the running Red Devils. I mean, we really earned our name back then.
Who was coached by Jerry Bradley, who was a former Ravenswood coach. He brought a team down here, and they had a kid by the name of Sidney Coles, who was Bimbo Coles' brother, and he ended up playing basketball at Memphis University and then came back and played at Marshall. They had a team that he brought down here, and they were triple A and we were double A, and we beat them by 30-some points.
It was really good basketball back, and we really, truly had the best out of each city. The first time I'd ever seen Coach Price out of plays, he just looked at me and said, just take it, score.
Then later on in that game, we need a timeout, we're out of timeout. One of the coaches, I won't say which one, took a water bottle and got some water on the floor, accidentally dropped the lid on purpose. That stopped the game. They got to talk to me a minute. I remember this because after the game, I go in to hug Coach Bradley, and I'll never forget Coach Bradley turned to me when I walked through the door and said, that was my own friend, my own buddy, that tried to hose me on the timeout with the water on the floor. And I said, well, you'd have done the same to him. And he said, yeah, I probably would.
1993 state tournament. That was the year we won our first state tournament game. What I'll always remember, but aside from that, is it was the blizzard of 93. You probably heard of that. Everybody talks about that. But we were stuck in Charleston, so we couldn't come back and forth. So we got to, as a team, we got to eat out in restaurants every night. We got to stay in a hotel. I mean, they put us four to a room, which was a mistake. Might have saved money, but man, we had a lot of fun. I mean, just running around the hotel and not sleeping much. Things you probably wouldn't want to do during a state tournament these days. But a bunch of kids from Ravenswood in the city of Charleston back, but that was a fun time.
Played here, it meant everything to be a Red Devil, to play for this team, play for Coach Price, play for the town. It was something that I remember growing up, being 6, 7, 8 years old, coming down, watching the early 90s, those players, and especially the 92, 93 era with Ryan Barney and those guys coming through. I mean, from that point on, I knew I wanted to play for Ravenswood, wanted to be a Red Devil.
So I just, you know, remember, you know, the bell ringing. Couldn't get over here fast enough. You know, we were always racing to get the best ball off the rack and be the first guy to switch one in. There was nothing like it. And just to get over here and be around my best friends and get a play for these guys. I mean, the coaching staff here just kind of helped pave the way for me in my life with everything. So it was just an unbelievable, you know, family atmosphere. And I look forward to going to practice every day just because of the way I felt when I was here and just being, you know, around those people who are my best friends and just unbelievable coaches. You couldn't lose in the section. You couldn't, you know, to go play. It was, you had to win all the way through. And at the time in our region, it was us and Poca and Winfield. And like in 2003, Poca had just come off, and they lost in the state championship, had everybody back. And they were, I think, number two in the state. And I think we were number three or four. And Winfield was really good. So it was like, there's gonna be two teams out of that region that don't even get to the state tournament that are probably top five teams in double A. You know, so it was tough. And Poca, you know, Alan Osborne was the coach, longtime coach, does a great job. They were really good that year. And we beat them. We actually played the game at Riverside. And that, to me, was the epitome of Ravenswood basketball. Bunch of different guys that played big roles that night and kind of did their thing.
Game went double overtime, crazy the way the whole played out. I think if I remember right, jumped out to a big lead. We came back and then it was back and forth all the way through to towards the end of regulation.
We ended up beating them and going to the state tournament. And it was just an unbelievable night. And to me, it was like a culmination of, and it was my senior year, it was kind of a culmination of everything I've been through in my entire life of Ravenswood basketball. And just being able to do that was special. And then we fell a little bit short in the state tournament, which was disappointing. But that was probably my best memory as a Red Devil.
The 2001 team was a rebuilding year, but they had a winning season. And then the 2002 and 2003 teams had a lot of the same players. Andy graduated in 2002 and Brett graduated in 2003. He said they had about eight kids in that group that that played on Boomtown. That team was a really good team. Again, you know, I could state it about almost every team in the 2000s, but definitely good enough to go to the state tournament. 2002 team lost another tough regional game to Poca. The 2003 team came back and beat Poca. You know, it could have been the other way, but that's just the way it works in basketball. That's just the way fate worked. But that 2000 team was really, really strong. Again, like most teams through that era, really most teams that we've coached here, if they had a majority of the kids back, they always use that as inspiration to try to go to that next level. You know, RJ Bader was a great player. And a kid named Josh Nelson who just came into his own that year. That team had some good juniors. And all the great teams in Ravenswood basketball, it's always one kid that just kind of a program player, you know? Most of the time, the great players, you know they're great when they're in the fifth, sixth grade. You know they're destined. They're going to be good. But it's that player that just keeps at it. You know, maybe when he's a freshman, they wouldn't even know when he was really on the team. But Josh Nelson was that type of player. I mean, he still has a school record for threes in a game. I mean, he made 13 threes. He had 39 points in a sectional game. Another team, they went 22-3. Just a bunch of great athletes, that, you know, just infused the Loons. Also, not only basketball, but the 2000-man Loons of football came alive again, too. I mean, went to a dominant team. Playoffs almost every year. Teams good enough that could have won it every year. We had a lot of those same athletes, and man, you know, they just didn't want to lose anything. Matter of fact, Ravenswood sports were just about, every sport was outstanding. That's when we had, you know, it's when my cross-country team started winning state championships, and we had kids that ran on those teams and played basketball, and then you had the football teams that was going to the playoffs every year and coming and playing basketball. So those kids, man, they just weren't going to lose. Teams have been close, but that was the most perfect team we had.
When you can come in here, you know, we pack the house every night. And when you're able to do that, and there's that much excitement in the town, every game's a memory. You know, every game you remember. We had some great Ripley games here. We beat Herbert Hoover in the sectional finals by 42 points. You know, that's a team that we played very tough, or they played us very tough throughout the season. We beat them by, I think, you know, 40, 42 points in the sectional finals. You know, those are good memories. A lot of great memories those seasons too. It is really hard to narrow it down, but the Logan game is one of the best, and I was lucky to be a part of it, but it's, looking back on it, I don't know if I've seen a better high school basketball game.
Single person knew their role. I mean, Anthony Sayer, you know, he was the man, he was getting it. And everybody knew he was getting it. We had Kurt Ritchie and Andrew Benford that were all seniors, grew up playing with each other. Kurt's twin brother Travis is one of the top guys off the bench. Then you had Dusty and Ben Wise, you know, they came in as sophomores and, you know, they knew their role. Then you had Ben Miller, who was a junior, and he was the sixth guy, and, you know, he knew his role. So everybody just played off of each other then. You know, they just had that bond. So that's what made that group so strong.
You know, our favorite place to hang out was probably the Ritchie house. That's probably where we spent the most time up on Hillcrest, was up at Todd and Candy's. You know, we even had pre-games, we would go up there sometimes, certainly post-game. So I would say that was a spot.
2006 is the first one, so that's always gonna be special. But we had the best team. We should have been undefeated if it hadn't been for some poor officiating at Parsburg Catholic. We would have been undefeated if official would have blown his whistle in the final minutes. But not that I hold a grudge about that. I did it.
Hey, Ravenswood basketball fans have been waiting for success over the years, 58 winning seasons and over 1,000 wins in school history. But for year after year, Championship Saturday would come and go. Titles would travel to all points of the state with no Ravenswood in sight. But today is different. In his 28th season, head coach Mick Price has orchestrated his greatest accomplishment, leading his beloved Red Devils into the Class AA Championship game.
Season was, it just had something special about it because we all just fed off one another perfectly, you know, and it just worked so well. I was just blessed to be able to step into a starting position my freshman year and to not just start on the team but have a scoring role on the team. I mean, I was the second leading scorer on the team, not because there weren't other gifted players, but because my game complemented Ant, I think, the best. We really played well together because if you put me and Ant on the same side, it made your decisions really tough because you either had to double off of me, at which point you kick it out and you get a three shot on you, or you just let Ant go one-on-one, and either way, it's not a good matchup for you. It wasn't just me, you know. There was a collective effort made from a lot of people, you know, and that's what made it so cool. We didn't have the mentality of, we'd like to go out and win every game. We had the mentality of, you're going to have to bring your best to even compete in this game tonight, you know, or else we're just going to blow you out of the water, so.
Civic Center Coliseum in Charleston with our score, Ravenswood 20, Bluefield 17. This is the Metro News Radio Network.
We're going to go down and we're going to give it our best shots, and we're 32 minutes away from Morgantown and we're going to play this.
Introducing Ravenswood's head coach, Mick Price.
Our goal every year was to get to the state tournament.
It's surreal when you get to that point because you're climbing that mountain and everything you're doing is trying to reach that. And there were times it looked like we were never going to reach
this. It was difficult setting at the Civic Center as a coach in the coaches section year after year knowing that we should be down here playing. That's been my goal since I came here, to win a state championship.
Well, that one is hit momentarily down the center. Jump from the right side. Taken by Big Rise on the wings. Just going to top the ball. It's down the center. For the center. Should be able to.
Starting in 07, that momentum just kept building from the 06 team. you know, the 07 team just took on a completely different personality because Ben Wise and Dusty Mullins, they had to be the leaders. That was a difficult role for them at first because they were still only juniors. You know, even though they had played in the state championship season, it was going to be different. Ben Miller became a starter. You know, Alex Cole moved into a starting role, and Bruce Patterson transferred and came in. And that 07 team went all the way to regional final, lost a really heartbreaking game to Winfield. So that just fueled their fire, man. Back in 08, we get a foreign exchange student that year. They had several very good seniors off the bench. Everything just came together with that team, man. I mean, that team just rolled from the beginning.
I remember one year, again, Ryan Benson, he hit a game-winning shot. I think it was his sophomore year, and it was a JV game. And he hits this game-winning shot against Ripley, and the whole student section in a JV game gets so excited that they're ready to storm the court. I mean, these were people that cared about how we did and cared about how the program did. It was phenomenal. The atmosphere, it was special. I mean, that's what we wanted to be a part of. Coach created a culture that made us want to show out for our town.
But in terms of, you know, best game ever too, I mean, it's hard to beat going off for 40 on senior night against Ripley. So that was really fun. I had 27 in the second half and only made one three-pointer. A lot of jump shots. It was a lot of creative, you know, let's just play basketball and just see who's better kind of stuff. And it was one of those nights where I think I could have shot backwards. Everything was just going in. I mean, I remember at one point I drove down the lane and Nathan McKinney grabbed my arm and I just kind of threw it up towards the rim and it just floated right. I didn't even know where the basket was. I just threw it up in that general direction, you know? It was just one of those nights, man. I mean, everything fell.
Maybe the most talented overall. That team had a little bit of everything.
Went 21-1. During the regular season, ranked number one the whole year, dominated sectional. Number one seed in the state tournament, rolled through Kaiser. Bluefield was a really strong team, beat them in the semifinal. Played Romine East in the final, had just beaten them in the last game of the regular season in the pit. And, you know, it just didn't go our way that day.
We lost in 08 in that state championship, which is devastating. I mean, that one, it hurt a lot of us. I mean, that was a tough pill to swallow, especially the way that we lost. But we go into that locker room, everybody's bawling their eyes out. You know, that was something that, again, it crushed you because this was the moment that you were waiting for your entire life. You get there and we were one bucket short. We still knew we had the support of Ravenswood. We still knew we had the support of Coach Price, but it was tough. But we're sitting in there and I was a sophomore at the time, I believe. And Nathan Gump and Dusty Mullins get up. Again, everybody's very emotional. This was before Coach Price or any of the coaches had come in. And those two get up, they speak to us as seniors, tell us how much they care about us, and they say to us, don't ever forget this feeling. You all do what you need to do to be back here next year and never let this happen to you again.
08, come home, nobody's here, man. Get off the bus, parents, few loyal supporters. But it's not because people don't care, it's because they don't know how to react. Everybody knows how to react when you win. Nobody knows how to really react when you lose. As a coach, you always feel tough for those kids because Coach Price and I, we just knew we were gonna continue to coach. Those kids weren't gonna have another year. So that makes it tough, and it's always hard to see those groups go. But then the 09 team comes back and they rally around each other.
Those were guys that had poured into it, that really cared about the program. Some of my best friends being some of the biggest roles in that.
2009 was a team that struggled at times. We went through a stretch where we shot terrible. But our defense became so good because they knew if they gave up more than 40 some points, we were going to win.
Probably a team that no one would have thought could win a state championship.
Wyoming East has become the program to beat in AA basketball. They entered the 2009 title game searching for a third straight championship. Ravenswood is into this game after an overtime semifinal win. If they muster the magic one more time.
AA title game, Ravenswood, Wyoming East. Sounds familiar.
Talk about Mick Price before he came to Ravenswood. Was the head coach at Sistersville High School.
Ravenswood in black, Wyoming East in whites. Gentry, Johnson, passes up the shot.
Sometimes when it's quiet, you'll hear Jesse Lester.
Seconds off the clock. And the Red Devils of Ravenswood and their head coach Mick Price celebrate the Class AA championship. What an accomplishment by the Ravenswood Red Devils.
Some of the players I played with, I mean, my whole life, so I mean, we grew up together, so. It's what I always wanted to do, to win a championship. I mean, we have one of the best programs in the state, so Coach Canberry and Coach Price have done an awesome job with that. I've always looked at Lad and Coach Brown when he was here. They did an awesome job with the program throughout the years, and I mean, Coach Price is one of the best coaches in the state, so I mean, it was awesome playing for him.
Next year, Luke Murray and Ron Benson brought that experience, attitude with them, and regrouped with some other players. And that team started out really, really strong. I think we were 12-2, 12-3, maybe 10-2, something like that. And went up to Magnolia at their home court and beat them. Luke Murray put on one of the better performances.
Best game that I personally played in was probably the Magnolia game at Magnolia my senior year. No one thought Magnolia was on top of everything that year. I mean, they thought they were gonna go and win it. And I ended up having, I don't know, 35 points or something. So that was probably the best game I played in.
And that team was really strong all year. Played New Orleans Red to come down here for 2 years. That 2010 team ended up 19-5, great year. 2011, 12 teams. They were good, they were strong. They both battled to the regional final as well. But then those 2 years we had to go to Magnolia. Both the 2011 and 12 teams played really strong on the road against Magnolia, but you know, just fell short. Both teams had their chances, but you know, for whatever reason, it just didn't go our way those nights.
Off
off-season, we had summer league games. We went to Williamstown several years and played on like a Wednesday night. We'd play some pickup ball here at the pit on Tuesday, Thursday, Sundays, just getting out and playing. And then we put on a camp for the young guys in the community, High River Basketball Camp. So that was always a lot of fun, getting to work with those youngins.
I personally had worked many camps. I was working 6 and 7 camps a summer because during the 70s and 80s, coaches weren't allowed to coach their kids. You weren't even allowed to have contact with them. So many coaches would go to basketball camps all over the East Coast of the United States, and they would bring their kids to the camps, and kids would get better. And I started thinking, okay, why is some kid paying $200-some to go to some camp someplace else when I could get that right here in Ravenswood for a whole lot less? So we started the Ohio River Basketball Camp. Let's get down to business. And it's one of the greatest things that I've done here at Ravenswood to help propel the program. I did it for the area of Ravenswood and the kids that's coming. What I didn't realize was we have kids from all over that come to that camp now. We average between 130 to 150 kids a year, grades 3 through 5, both boys and girls. And it has been a tremendous asset, not only for those kids to start at a very young level, but for our varsity basketball players, both girls and boys, to be counselors where they have to work with these young kids because these kids are looking up to them. And we brought great guest speakers in. We have a great camp. We've had many businesses that have helped us with making sure kids don't have to pay for the camp shirts and they win awards and prizes. It's one of the best things going on in Ravenswood that some people forget about. But man, we bring a lot of people in for 4 days a week in this town, and the gyms are packed and it's fun.
Pre-game stuff was always is always a little wild, especially when you get to the varsity level. Varsity guys go out, watch the JV guys until about the third quarter is almost over. Come back to the locker room, start getting your mind right, and then when we go play games all around the state where I coach now at Roane County High School, we'll still meet people and we'll get to talking and say, oh, where'd you play high school ball? When I say Ravenswood, man, there's always just a, oh, man, he played for a really good program.
In the house. It felt like it was standing room only. It was hot, which I'm sure a lot of people have said that's one of the biggest factors. It's always hot in here. But I'd say my favorite memory in the pit would by far be my junior year against Tug Valley. They came in acting like they owned the place. And we whipped them up pretty good during the game, and it was just sweet because they were one of our biggest rivals. We respected them, but we sure didn't like them. That was my favorite memory, beating them here.
My dad wanted me to go to Ripley, so I kind of fueled like the fire a little bit because I didn't want to go there because I like of all the things my grandpa and like my mom's friends, like my grandpa who has, you know, always been here. So it was like I don't want to go to Ripley, like Ripley, like you don't want to go over there, like they're like day soccer or whatever. The culture is way different here, like the traditions and the way like things are done around here. It's like when I come to their practices, we were doing the same thing when I was in high school. it's always like a culture kind of thing. Like it's very like done the same way. Like it works, like obviously because of the trophies behind you. Like everybody around you knows you. Like when you go to a game, you see somebody saying your name, like, hey, good game Friday or whatever. Like the culture around you. And then the locker room is always the same because it's Red Devil basketball and everybody loves it for a reason.
The offense all 4 years I was here was built around team success. Let's say someone scores 40 points. Well, the rest of the team didn't play well. You didn't play good defense. You turned the ball over too much. It didn't matter. The way it worked here, everybody depended on one another, and I felt like that's what made us so successful here.
Everything. I mean, whenever I was playing for the Red Devils, that's who I was. I was a Ravenswood High School varsity basketball player, and that is something that was special to me then, and special to me now, and always will be. It was everything. Again, the community is incredible here. They're always involved with everything. They're always supportive, willing to help out, and be there for the players and the coaches.
Yeah, those guys were maniacs. I mean, I still feel like it was the best student section in the entire state. Not only at the pit, but man, they traveled well. They were Red Devil fans. They were ready to bring their A game when it came to cheering us on, and we fed off of that. Anybody will ask. I mean, you see all these empty stadiums during COVID. I don't know what we would have done if that was the case that year. The atmosphere for the pit, it felt like the fans were right on top of you. In the student section, they'd put their arms out, try to touch the other players. I mean, my goodness.
And the program, I mean, not only just the coaching staff we had, which was incredible, former players coming back, so support staff, just top of the line in every facet.
The most fun I had was when we played St. Joe in the first round of like the state tournament, because during that year we went to Civic Center like the same year and we played St. Joe, and we lost by like 10 or something like that. We got our like revenge, you know, so we got our like bounce back game. Got to play them in the first round of the tournament. We were kind of nervous, but you know, I was in kill mode, so I didn't really care. I ended up scoring like 30 something.
They can't stop Riley, guys.
Ron Lewis is referring to as the record breakers was my senior basketball team, the 2018 team. I think we broke insane amount of records, I feel like. The group of guys I played with, I mean, you couldn't ask for a better group of guys. We've been playing together since we were in third grade. Most definitely my senior year team had the best chemistry. I believe that's why we were so successful, because we'd been together, we'd done it before, and it was nothing new for us once we got into high school.
My favorite game of all time would be my senior year, the semifinal game when we played Tug Valley. That was our only loss of the year going into that game, and it's just a team that we had battled with over the years. So for us, it was just kind of like a culmination of our whole high school basketball experience.
We'll be right back.
Bring you courtside here at the pit at McPrice Court tonight.
It's that time of year, Heath. The playoffs are upon us, the postseason play.
This atmosphere has quickly turned into a packed environment, primarily wearing red and black. The head coach for the Runnin' Red Devils is Mick Price. Assistant coaches are Brian Canterbury and Andy Wise.
They are bought in, and they will make sure that every day in practice they're leaving no stone unturned. It's going to be quite a season for the Red Devil faithful to get back here in the gym and pack it, because these kids are excited. I'm telling you, these kids are fun to watch play because they've got a little bit of skill. And now that they're a little bit bigger and a year older, they're all back, they're a little more physically mature, a little more body, been working on the weight system, been out running a little bit. I'm really excited to see what this team has in its future. I really am. Guys come back, and I hope they can come back. It's going to be a special night. I hope when they come back to Ravens, they look at it and say, you know what? They still got it going here. You know what? These guys have kept this thing going. And that's why I wanted the day I walk out of the back of this gym and go over and sit and drink some iced tea on the back porch. I want the next guy to come in and say, keep your tradition alive.
It's a big deal.
We had some tremendous fellas on there. I really appreciated them playing ball with me. They didn't get the recognition that I did. They should have. You know, I couldn't have done what I did without them.
There we were. And those are the guys that made the year for our basketball team.
I still support Ravenswood basketball. I like it. You know, of course, I'm a lot older now.
It was a thrill to be on the team and playing because it was such a community event. To me, growing up, it was what I lived for, really.
As far as this documentary, I think it shows just how much pride Coach Price brings to this program. He doesn't care just about this season. He cares about everyone, and he wants the history to be so important. History is something that is so important as it is, because through our history, we attain and understand and able to progress forward. And what a great job he does.
What I didn't realize when I played here was that it was going to continue. It wasn't going to stop. You become part of the family.
think as a broadcaster, your job is to paint a picture for those that can't be there. You know, a mental image that you don't necessarily get from a TV broadcast. You can actually see that when you're watching a TV screen. When you're listening to the radio, the broadcaster, in my opinion, is to paint a picture for those that are sitting back at home.
He's always amazed me, his ability to do that. I really don't need to step in much whenever he's painting the picture, you know, the left to right on your radio dials, all that stuff. So I get to do the fun stuff. You know, I get to maybe harp on the officiating if there's a little call here and there. I've been over there notorious for trying to get the crowd pumped up.
Getting the old babies in.
The old babies, get those in every now and then. And, you know, it's just so much fun. And getting to do the games, not only just as a broadcaster, but as brothers and a team to be able to do those, it's been so much fun.
Dave Hood was one of the most inspirational people that I've ever been associated with as a coach. Unfortunately, Dave passed. But it was so important to him to play for Ravenswood and the Red Devils. And he has inspired so many with his struggle with Lou Gehrig's. And he has inspired players on this team, the coaches, and everybody. Dave and I was going to New Martinsville. We were playing Magnolia that night. And Dave was having trouble getting up on the bus at that point. He was in a wheelchair. And I had Dave in the car with me. I took him in the car so he could go. And we're halfway between St. Mary's and Sistersville. I'll never forget on Route 2. And we talk about 100 different things. Because we were close. Everything from biblical scripture to the Browns suck. And you know it. Why do you keep rooting for them since I'm a Steeler fan? So it was easy to talk with Dave. I said, Dave, I'm going to ask you this. You don't have to tell me. I said, of all the great things you've done, of all the people, you ever get mad at God because of the condition that you're in? I mean, do you ever get said, why me? I mean, I could have done so much more. And he looked over at me and said, why not me? Look how many people I can affect positively now. I couldn't talk. I couldn't breathe. I'm thinking, the most selfless thing that a person could say. And I didn't say anything. But you got another question? I'm like, if I could talk, I'd ask you a question. I mean, it really just tore my soul up because I knew how important him going up to New Martinsville that night was. And you wouldn't even know he had a wheelchair or Lou Gehrig's. He was so positive. He really affected so many people. And we miss him, and we love him, and I hope that we make him proud. Because he's one of those guys that you look up in the stars, you say, hey, the win was for you. The Red Devil, you know. And you know he's jumping around up there someplace in those red shoes. And, you know, it is guys like that have inspired me to go on and do stuff when you may not feel like it or you may not want to do it, but you want it to be the best it can be. He was a great inspiration to me. Jerry Bradley passed. He and I are like brothers.
You know, I told you about Jerry saying, hey, don't ever be embarrassed of your parents. It was that. It was that kind of thing. And I apologize, I got emotional, but I think about Coach Bradley. It was that kind of attention to kids that mattered to that coaching staff. And I think that's why today we all come back. It isn't for a school or to see your name on the wall or to walk through the gym and think you're all this. It's for these guys. I am Lord.
But I remember coming into the games, and one of the earliest memories of seeing the Red Devils was Ernie Reese's senior year. And just watching, I mean, those guys were amazing. You know, you're sitting there thinking, I cannot wait to get up there and play in the pit in front of all those people.
Never quit. Never quit would have to be one of the biggest lessons I've learned from this coaching staff.
Those guys were good dudes, and you know, so I was very lucky not just to play with dudes that I really liked, but to have guys in front of me that made me feel like a part of it and cared about me and, you know, tried to, you know, just kind of help me as a person. So that was something that I'll never forget.
If you could just go down and start listing them, they've had impact on this program and the kids. It's just amazing. But most of all, I'd like to thank the players. Because I know we weren't always easy to get along with because we were very demanding. But they always performed. And all this is because of them. You know, they built this. We didn't. We just tried to show them the way. And they put the effort. They were the ones running up and down the court, making the plays, sweating, everything else. We're just a bunch of old guys sitting over on the side, yelling. They all hold a special place in my heart.
I guess, you know, the number one thing, I just hope that they will remember that, you know, I was the type of coach that, you know, always put the players first. You know, Coach Price and I, the other great coaches, you know, I always say, that I'm the luckiest coach around. Not only have I coached great Ravenswood kids, but I've got to coach with my friends. I mean, I've not coached one day without someone that I call a dear friend.
That's the thing about Ravenswood. When you have a special program like this, you know those players, right? I mean, you know what they did because, you know, the coaching staff puts together a basketball program that rivals colleges. It's great, you know. Not everybody does that. You're a 10-year-old kid, you open up that program, you want to be in that program. So I think, you know, stuff like that that not everybody does. You know, you're not going to go to a lot of schools, even the, you know, look at the LKC. You go to a lot of schools, see if you can find a basketball program that rivals this one. It's not going to happen.
The number one lesson I learned was how to work for something that you want to achieve. And realizing that without hard work, you're not going to achieve. You may achieve it, but you won't achieve it the way you want to.
The basketball program helped shape me, helped keep me out of trouble, keep me from doing things I didn't need to be doing. The coaching staff, they cared. They wanted you to be successful. They still want you to be successful. And I think this program has had a positive influence on everybody that's came through. I think that's the reason you have so many former players coming back. So many former players in contact with Coach Price all the time. You know, you got former players coaching, you got Taylor Woods coaching at Riverside.
That's special. Again, it's the Ravenswood way that once you're a Red Devil, you're always a Red Devil.
Coach has had so many different guys come through here that's coaching places, and they always come back. They always want to see Coach Price, and I'm just so appreciative of the opportunities that I had here to be a part of the program, to play with so many great players that I did. Walk in the same footsteps, the same locker room, the hallway. The tradition is unmatched. It was so much fun. I was so proud. I'm still proud. And it was a blessing to be able to play for the Ravenswood High School basketball program.
What do you hope that the people of Ravenswood, or anybody that's come through your program, remembers about Mick Price, the person?
Wow. That is a loaded question. You know, as a coach, you touch more people's lives than probably anybody, as a coach and a teacher. And you can do it a lot of different ways. And I think it's my responsibility as a coach not to wait till the last game you lose and go over to the Board of Education and pick up a paycheck. I could care less. I'm not a millionaire by any means. I'm not even a thousandaire, if there's such a thing. We lived a paycheck to paycheck, just like most of the people do. But I hope that whatever they saw from me was a person that found the good in them and made them better and was positive, high energy, and gave something to them that they could take no matter what they chose to do in a life. Doctor, lawyer, Indian chief, I don't care what you want to be. I hope that the things that we did here or what I did here, that they saw me on a daily basis. Some men of coaches, he's out there painting. He's in there working hard. What's he doing? He's got practice plans pinned up already. I mean, what's he doing now? He's sweeping the floor. Where's he at now? He's putting chairs out. I mean, sweeping, you know, people don't see that stuff. I want them to think that, you know, you're never too big. And I also want them to think that you're not entitled to stuff. You have to work for what you get. And I hope that the people that I have been around, that I have touched, I hope they feel that you're not entitled to anything. I don't care how much money you got. I don't care what your last name is. I don't care about what kind of car you drive. When you leave here, you're going to take some tools with you to help you in your next step in life, preparation for college or whatever job it is. And I would hope from Mick Price that they saw somebody that actually walked the talk. He's doing it. I mean, and I don't think about that. I don't think about walking the talk because, as I said to you, it's a passion. You know, there are some people that suffer because of my passion, like my family. There's no way that I could do what I do without Susan, Melissa, Katie, and Kelsey. My three daughters that I'm so proud of because they're nurses. Now, they may not say it or they may not think it, but, you know, yes, we've won some great games and I'm proud of, but I'm not any more proud of any of that than I am with maybe the daughters that they have become and what they're doing now. I mean, that's what I'm most proud of, your family, because they're the ones that's going to carry on what you gave them. And my wife, Susan, how in the world to be a coach's wife? You got to be an idiot. You got to be crazy to be a coach's wife. You get yelled at the store. You get yelled at PTA meetings. You get yelled at the women's circle at church. You get yelled at because Johnny's not starting. He cut him. He yelled at him last night. You know, they got to watch where they even go. Why, my gosh, she's the foot of the church to me. She's my root. She's my person that makes me special. And on a night when she knows things didn't go well for me or the Red Devil team, she's there. She's there also there supporting when things are going well. So I couldn't have done it without those people in my family. And I got to not only mention my immediate family, but my family back in Mannington, aunts, uncles, grandma, grandpas, cousins, nephews, they all come to the games. They're all at the games, no matter where we play. They make a commitment. So I hope that what I've got from them just being, going to a one-room country school growing up to a one-room school that out in Flat Run, that I'm not bigger than anybody and I'm not afraid to pick up the trash and I'm not afraid to do other things. I'm not too good for that. I hope that's what kids got from it. And along the way, if they're a better person from discipline, if they're a better person from being on time, if they're a better person from doing the right thing at the right time, even when it's not popular to be right, if they've learned how to sacrifice a little bit, if they've learned out how in practice, when it's tough and their hands are on the knees, stand up. Let's go, we're going another one. If they learn to give that little bit more in order to be a champion, that's what a champion is. And I hope I got a whole bunch of champions out there. Just because you win a state championship doesn't mean, that doesn't, the only reason you're a champion. You're a champion in life. You're a champion, you're taking things with you and you're gonna give that to others. And I really hope that's what people see. I don't want them to say, well, there goes Mick Price, he's won a couple basketball games. Because the first thing I'd say, well, we lost a few too. I can tell you a lot more about the wins than I can the losses. And I can tell you this, I hate losing way more than I like winning. And that's why I maybe work so hard so our teams can be successful. But I don't want them to tag me just as Tim. I want to be a person that somebody can pick up a phone and say, hey coach, I got a situation, can you help? Of course I can. Of course I can. That's the kind of bond I want with all those people. All they have to pick up the phone, I have to call them every day to know that they can do that. And I think that's what this Red Devil Nation is about. And I'm really hoping that during this 100 years celebration, I'm really hoping that some of these guys that played on these teams that can get back and reconnect and stay together where they're at. Atlanta, Houston, Sacramento, Chicago, New York. I don't care where they're from. Keep connected because we were special. And it was a special time in your life. And you don't get that back. I'm not saying it prerequisites everything that you're doing in your life. You can be very successful. But those days you rode on a bus and it was cold and you went and beat somebody someplace and you're on the bus, special. You don't get it back. Those days you didn't want to come to practice and you got out there and here's Coach Price going 90 miles an hour, let's go. Those are going to be special days because you did that a little bit more. Those days in the locker room before you get out and you can say what you want to say, say let's go. Let's go. This is our house. Pit. Those times in the timeout. And there's down one, and there's 10 seconds left, and you gotta execute. And they look at each other and say, we've done this in practice. Let's go, let's just execute. Gosh, those are special. And all those guys that played for those teams and that did that, that's what makes running Red Devil a special place. Not Mick Price, those things.